Hi, let's talk about vasculature, or in other words, the vessels that connect your heart to the metabolically active tissues of your body. So leaving the heart are arteries. These are the vessels that conduct blood to the metabolically active tissues. Now, most vessels are comprised of three layers, or tunics. There's the tunica externa, tunica media, and deep, the tunica interna. The tunica externa of the artery is the outermost layer that consists of collagen and other connective tissues. And this is going to surround the tunica media. The tunica media in an artery consists of layers of smooth muscle, and these can be quite variable with respect to the number of layers. And then an external elastic lamina, which provides a little bit of tone to the vessel. The tunica interna consists of a layer of simple squamous epithelium supported by a basement membrane, surrounded by an internal elastic lamina. Together, these three layers provide the vessel with enough support and tone and elasticity to move blood away from the heart so that it may be delivered to those metabolically active tissues. Now, there are two major types of arteries, elastic and muscular. The elastic arteries typically are larger, more major arteries, such as the aorta and the pulmonary trunk. These are arteries with a high amount of a particular type of protein called elastin in their walls that are able to serve as pressure reservoirs to absorb the relatively large pressure put on the blood as it exits the heart, and then squeeze back into its more typical anatomical position. Muscular arteries, or distributing arteries, are branches from elastic arteries. These are the other typically named arteries that are able to distribute the blood throughout the body. Arteries feed into arterioles. Arterioles then feed into thoroughfare channels, which control blood into capillaries, and those capillaries can then go back into thoroughfare channels, into muscular venules, into veins, and return to the heart. Microcirculation is all of the vessels between the arteriole and the venule. So as we can see here, from the met arteriole through the thoroughfare channel into the venule is microcirculation. In the action of the cardiovascular system, the filtrate from the blood into the interstitial tissues occurs at the level of the capillary bed. The exchange of nutrients, the exchange of gases, the movement of hormones, the movement of waste products, and even by proxy, the movement of heat is a phenomenon that is controlled by the capillaries. On the left here, we can see capillaries that are fully engorged with blood. And that's a function of these precapillary sphincters from the thoroughfare channel being relaxed so that blood can flow through the capillary beds. On the right, we can see what happens when those precapillary sphincters are shut tight. That prevents the blood from moving into the capillary beds, and it forces it through the thoroughfare channel back to the venule, and then that will eventually be returned to the heart. Capillaries themselves, as the site of exchange, are remarkably simple. They consist of two layers, an endothelium, which is simple squamous epithelia, supported by a basement membrane. Now, if you recall, those two layers correspond with the tunica interna of the artery. The capillary is generally about 8 to 10 micrometers in diameter, and that's approximately the diameter of an erythrocyte or a red blood cell. So these red blood cells are typically going to move through capillary beds one at a time and have ample opportunity to unload oxygen, pick up carbon dioxide, and participate in that exchange. The muscular venules feed into veins, and veins, by definition, are vasculature that returns blood to the heart. Like arteries, veins have three layers. A tunica externa, which is very similar to the tunica externa of arteries. A tunica media, which, unlike arteries, is typically very, 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 very thin. And a tunica interna, which is very similar to arteries. It's simple squamous epithelium supported by a basement membrane. What you'll notice is that there are no elastic laminae as part of veins. And also, there's an elaboration of the tunica interna in that some veins have involutions or infoldings of that simple squamous epithelium so that a valve is formed. These valves promote the unidirectional flow of blood. This is helpful because pressure within veins is extraordinarily low relative to the pressure of arteries. Blood pressure in the vessels after a capillary bed is very low. And as a consequence of that, blood needs some extra help to be moved along. There are a few ways in which the body can help promote the flow of blood through veins. One very easy way is by means of gravity. So for instance, any of the veins that are superior to the heart, that aren't involved in the upper limb, may be passively drained via gravity. But this in and of itself is insufficient in order to return blood even from those areas, because you can imagine that astronauts in a microgravity environment still have the need to return blood back from their head. And so we have other means by which we can encourage the flow or the movement of blood in veins. All of these means exert extrinsic pressure on the veins and the blood within the veins. So a few of these include muscle milking via skeletal muscles. And so what happens here is that muscles that are adjacent to veins, as they contract, they squeeze the veins, pushing the blood through one valve to the next compartment. Another means of extrinsic pressure on veins is through respiration. By changing the volume of the abdominal and the thoracic cavity by the diaphragm, depressing and elevating, you change the relative pressures of these spaces. And by changing the relative pressures of these spaces, you can exert force on the inferior vena cava to help promote the flow of blood. The third way that we can provide extrinsic pressure on a vein is rather ingenious, and that is veins can accompany arteries. And as arteries are pulsatile vessels, that is, they throb, that pulsation exerts adjacent pressure on the veins, which helps move blood through the veins. Veins which accompany arteries and make use of their pulsatile nature are referred to as venocomitantes. And finally, there are times when the valves of veins fail. And so typically what we'll see is if there's any backflow from a vein, the valve catches it and closes it, and the blood at least remains within that particular segment of the vein. But if the valve were to fail, if we have any incompetence of that valve, blood may flow in reverse or retrograde from one compartment to the next. And then pressure can build up on the walls of these veins. That enlarges the vein, and it gives the overall appearance of larger, more tortuous, sometimes curved veins. People refer to these as varicosities or varicose veins. This is typically a phenomenon within the superficial veins of the lower limb. It may be painful. It may produce a burning sensation. It's not generally medically significant, and some people may elect to treat these cosmetically. So we've talked about the vessels that carry blood away from the heart, the vessels that exchange nutrients, gases, and waste products, and then the vessels that return blood to the heart. Let's look at some of these individual vessels and think about the tissues that they supply. Thank you.